is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. These are the kids. These are the kids that will live in God. That will live in God. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Amen.
Somebody to press a button on the machine back there. So if someone could go back to the cassette player. Okay, it's going to be the top device. And it's the left cassette, which is, I think, A. And all you're going to have to do is hit play. I wasn't expecting to do this, but you're like, oh, well, why does she have a performance track with her? I sang this morning. That's why I happen to actually be prepared, kind of, sort of. Let's hope I don't get lost like I did this morning. So. Oh, are you or not?
Already.
Don't tell anybody, I know.
Thank you.
might be the.
I'm so glad that you died for me, and I'm so glad that you shed your blood for me, and I'm so glad that you rose for me, sweet Jesus. Jesus, sweet Jesus, Jesus, I'm so glad that you died for me. I'm so glad that you shed your blood just for me. I'm so glad that you rose for me, sweet Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Sweet Jesus, Jesus, so y'all help me sing, Jesus, 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 sweet Jesus, oh yeah. Precious name,
Amen.
Thank you to everybody, Ariana, my children, my mother, for those wonderful songs that were sung, that glorifies, that gives praise, glory, and honor to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I would ask, if you don't have a handout, you're going to need it today. If you're not familiar with my style of preaching, it's going to be a lot of scripture, a lot of word, a lot of explanation of God's holy word, and it would help you if you had it to follow along, so you don't have to do any flipping. It's all right there for you. So if you guys don't mind, please stand, and we will be reading our main text. And our main text for today is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 through 4, and Romans chapter 8, verse 11. And it reads, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel, which I preach to you, which you also receive, and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast to that word which I preached to you, unless you believe in vain. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures." Romans 8:11. "But if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you." This is God's word. You may be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come here today giving you praise, glory, and honor. We ask, Lord, as your word go forward, that you would open the eyes of people to see your gospel, that they may repent and be saved. And we ask this in the precious and marvelous name of Jesus. Amen. Today is a day that we find more people in churches all over the country, more than usual, as we come and we celebrate Resurrection Sunday. But I would like to propose to you that, especially in this country, Christianity is no longer Christianity.
Yeah.
Christianity has been redefined and has made up a false Jesus that is unrecognizable to the scriptures at all. And the reason why we have done that is simply because we love our sin. And because we love our sin, we're going to make up a God who also loves our sin, so that we could continue to live in sin and not have to answer before a holy God. But that's not what the scriptures testify to at all. Today I would like to go through what's known as biblical theology, which means to recap the redemptive story of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who was called into play by God the Father, executed by God the Son, and we are made alive by God the Holy Spirit. I want to propose to you today not just a bunch of lofty verses that I've heard growing up that I had no idea what they meant or the reason for them. I want to present to you today the gospel in a way that explains exactly why Christ died, exactly why Christ lived, exactly why he rose again, and exactly what that means for us who believe. Amen. But exactly what that means for those who don't believe as well. The big idea I want you to get from this message is that evidence of believing the gospel is resurrection power demonstrated in how you live your life in devotion to God and his holy scriptures. So today, let me introduce to you my sermon title, "He is Alive, But Are You?" Amen. He is alive, but are you? First point up front, you can reject the resurrection either by word or by lifestyle. You can reject the resurrection, which is the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can reject that by word or by lifestyle. Let's look at an example real quick as we go through the scriptures. That's what we do here. Of what it looks like when somebody hears the gospel, receives the gospel, and the power of the gospel. Let's take a look at that. Acts chapter 16, we're going to cover verse 10, 13, 14, and 15. This is Paul and the scenario of Paul in the book of Acts. Now, after he had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go to Macedonia. Concluded that the Lord had called us to do what? To preach the gospel to them. Now, we're going to go over in great detail what this gospel is. So that there will be nothing up for, I don't know what the gospel is. We're going to know exactly what the gospel is today. To preach the gospel to them. Verse 13, and on the Sabbath day, we went out of the city to the riverside where prayer was customarily made. And we sat down and spoke to the women who met there. Verse 14. Now a certain woman named Lydia heard us. She was a seller of purple from the city of Thyatira who worshiped God. The Lord opened her heart to heed the things spoken by Paul. And when she and her household were baptized, she begged us, saying, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come to my house and stay. So she persuaded us. This is what happens when the gospel is preached, and the gospel that is preached and that is received by faith through by grace through faith. This is what happens. Look what Lydia did. It's right there in your notes. We know she believed it because of her actions. What did she do? The commandment is to go and be baptized. She went and said, no, I want to be baptized. Because she believed, she started to act on what God has said in his word. That's the power of the gospel. That I am going to do what the scriptures say because it is that much power in the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we see here that when she believed, actions followed. Next, we see that she desired to be faithful to the Lord. Look at what she says. She says, and when she and her household were baptized, she begged us, saying, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, she desires to be faithful to the Lord. That is what the gospel does. It desires you to be faithful to the Lord. She immediately, and then point three, she immediately wants to serve God and his people. Ladies and gentlemen, if that's not you after you heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, I need you to question whether you are saved because you are denying resurrection power. What we need is more gospel giving, because gospel giving will result in actions being changed because you have a new heart. And once you have a new heart, you do new things. You do different things. You don't live no more to glorify yourself. You live to glorify God in every single thing you do in your life. This is the resurrection power of the gospel. If this isn't your experience, you need to make sure you are saved. Colossians chapter 3, verse 4. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. There's no such thing, saints, as a part-time Christian. Christ is your life when you become a Christian. Either he gave you a new heart or you still got that old one. There is no such thing as he gave you a half a heart or you still got this heart of stone and you got a heart of flesh. No, either you're saved or you're not. People come and they look at me after I got saved and I was dead of trespasses and sins and I lived a horrific life. But when I truly repented and believed the gospel, God consumed my life. He completely consumed my life. I could no longer live in sin anymore because the conviction of the Holy Spirit ate me up. I would try, it wouldn't work because the gospel had that much power. Resurrection power. That's how much power is in the gospel. And anybody who continues to live in sin, you are denying resurrection power. That means you have denied the gospel and you are still in your sins and you will have to deal with the wrath of God. Proof of not believing the gospel, but believing in vain. Remember, Paul, he shows that the gospel is what saves you. The gospel is the reason why you stand. He has all of these promises that come with the gospel, but then he throws this in there, unless you believe in vain. We don't believe you can lose your salvation. Once you have repented and believed the gospel, you are sealed with the power of the Holy Spirit, and you cannot lose your salvation, but you could have never believed in the first place. And that is evident by how you live your life. And there's evidence of that. Let's look. 1 Corinthians, same book. Remember, our main passage of scripture came from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 through 4. Same letter that Paul is giving in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 through 11. Now listen to this. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? What does that mean? That means you ain't going. I don't care what anybody comes and tell you. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? That means you're not going to heaven. That means that you are subject to God's wrath and you will live in total separation from God forever. That means, whether we like to say it in church or not, that you will be thrown in hell and later the lake of fire. That's Bible, whether you like it or not. We can try to recreate this new God all we want to. The culture said God, he gets us. God don't get sin.
No, he doesn't.
Amen. He don't get it. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexual, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And that is not an exhaustive list. What does he say? Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. If this is you, if you're still making a practice of these things, if this is still a part of your everyday life, Paul wants you to know, don't be deceived. I don't care what somebody else got up and told you. I don't care about what my mama said, what my dad said, what my cousins told me. I don't care about none of that. The Bible says, God breathed out word, says, don't be deceived. These actions, those who make a practice of these things with no conviction of the Holy Spirit, practice generally means if I'm practicing it, I don't have any conviction of the Holy Spirit. If this is you, don't be deceived. You have denied resurrection power. In context for 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul later drops down later in that chapter and starts talking about what if Christ wasn't raised from the dead. You have some who will say out of their mouth, even in Paul's day, we don't believe in a resurrection. We have many in our day who will say that they believe in a resurrection, but their life says there is no resurrection. Because resurrection power results in living a resurrected life. Point two, anyone who believes in vain has been deceived, and their lifestyle testifies. A person who believes in vain experiences no difference in their life and continues to make a practice of sin. A person who makes a practice of sin without conviction of the Holy Spirit has been deceived and is not a Christian because they have rejected the power of the resurrection. A person who believes in vain will not hold fast because they have never repented and believed the gospel. But Paul doesn't leave them with no hope in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 9 and 10. Verse 11, he shows the contrast to that. He says, look what he says in verse 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11. And such were some of you. Past tense.
Amen.
Such were some of you. Such were some of you. He did not say that is who you are now. If that is who you are now, then you have been deceived. And you have believed in vain. And such were some of you. But you were washed. But you were sanctified. But you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God.
Hallelujah.
Those who have truly repented and believed the gospel will live totally committed lives to God. Doesn't mean we don't sin. We fall short of the glory of God every day. But we are constantly repenting and we are constantly being led by the Holy Spirit to live a life that is glorifying to God. That is a Christian. Amen. There's no such thing as a carnal Christian where I'm in the club, but I'm in church too. There's no such thing. That is a God that culture has made up and you have drank the Kool-Aid. Because there's no such thing as that. So how is this possible for us to be washed, sanctified, justified, and have this power to live this life that really in my flesh I don't really want to live? I don't want to stop cussing. I don't want to stop drinking to be drunk as a lifestyle. I don't want to stop gossiping. I don't want to stop being mean to people. I don't want to stop doing all the things that I do that I know is contrary to the word of God. How am I to have this power if I don't want to?
God makes you want to.
Amen. That's the power of the gospel. the power of the gospel changes your desires. It changes your desires. How is this possible? Because of the gospel. Well, what is the gospel? Now we got to go back to our main text. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3. He says, for I delivered to you, first of all, which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Verse 4, and that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. The first question is, why did Christ need to die for my sins? I have seen some seasoned saints that say they've been saved for 50 years, 60 years, 70 years. I'm not lying. That could not tell me. And it bothers me, Pastor. It bothers me that I can come up here and I can ask you, why did Christ come? Why did Christ live? Why did Christ die for your sins? And it's this generic answer that a Muslim would give. Don't know the gospel. Have no clue to why Christ had to come and die for your sins. You have a false view of who God is, and you have a false view of who you are. Why did Christ need to die for my sins? Let's go back to the beginning. Let's start a little bit of biblical theology. Because Adam rebelled against the holy God, and his sin nature was inherited by us, making us enemies of God, deserving death, hell, and the lake of fire. Oh, I know culture hate that. Oh, I know they hate that. I deserve death, hell, and the lake of fire. I'm not as bad as him. I ain't kill nobody. I ain't murder nobody. You have a false ideology of yourself because you and me are rotten.
Amen.
Rotten. Apart from Christ, we all are rotten. And if we don't start with the fact that we need a Savior, you can't blame nobody else. Well, this happened to me because this person did this to me, or this man or this woman did this to me. If you don't start with the idea that you are rotten and that you're dead in trespasses and sins, you have believed in vain. It starts with understanding your need for a Savior first.
Amen. Praise.
You need a Savior. But if I have a false conception of who I am and a false ideology of who God is, how on earth can I say I believe the gospel? That's why you have no resurrection power. And that's why when before I got saved, I would come to church. My father's a preacher. I had no resurrection power because I didn't understand my need for a Savior. I didn't understand that I was dead in trespasses and sins. I thought because I wasn't as bad as that guy that I was good. What a lie. I drank the Kool-Aid. I was deceived. I was deceived. God commanded Adam. Let's go back. Look at the scripture. We say that Adam sinned, and his sin nature was passed on to us. So let's see what happened here. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. Verse 15. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to tend and to keep it. So God created man for a reason. And we see in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, he created man to rule and to have dominion. And now we see that he put him in the garden to tend and to keep it. And the Lord God said in verse 16, the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day you eat of it you shall surely die. God was good to Adam, but he created Adam for a purpose. He created Adam to glorify him, just like he created all of us. God created us to glorify him. This is the thing. You ain't created to glorify yourself. You're not created to glorify your flesh. That is a misconception. You are not created for you. I don't feel like getting up every day and going to work. But I know that the Bible says that I must take care of my family as the man of the house. So it ain't about what I feel like no more. It's about what thus says the Lord. I don't live for me. I live to glorify him. So therefore, what he says in these scriptures must be how I live my life. Remember, Christ is my life. God created Adam for a reason. And that is for you are to rule. You are to tend this garden. You are to proclaim the word of God. You are to shepherd over your family. But you don't eat from this tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Why? Because I determine what's good, and I determine what's evil. Adam, you don't determine what's good, and you don't determine what's evil. That's half of our problem. I want to say what's good, and I want to say what's evil that is apart from God's word.
Amen.
This is how we got into this in the first place. I want to define what's good, and I want to define what's evil. We got a God who has already laid that out.
Yeah.
He has defined what's good, and he has defined what is evil.
Preach, Pastor.
That is it. He's already defined what it is. He don't need us to try to redefine what he has already defined, because what we have done is made up a false God called him Jesus that allows us to redefine whatever it is that we want. False Jesus, false gospel, believed in vain, you've been deceived. But we all know what Adam did. Adam rebelled against God's command. Genesis 3:6. So when the woman saw the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Now, I'm not going to get into all the idiosyncrasies of this story, as I typically do, but this is how sin entered the world. One, to be independent of God. God has defined something. We redefine. We do what we want to do. We want to say what's good. We want to say what's evil. We want to do what we want to do, not what God said. That is outright rebellion against a holy God, and he hates it. He created us to glorify him, not to live in rebellion against us. Against him. Point three. Adam sinned against a holy God, which resulted in spiritual death or separation from God for him and all his descendants. That's me and you. Because Adam sinned, we all inherited Adam's sin nature, meaning that we are born spiritually dead.
Amen.
That's what happened. Adam sinned. And we inherited his sin nature. We come out enemies of God. I know that's hard for you to believe. And my little baby that's in diapers, in his core being, he wants to go against God. I'm going to say like Bodie Balcom said, that's a viper in a diaper. That is a viper in a diaper. That sin nature was passed right on to you and right on to your children. Hard truth. But that's Bible. Don't believe me. Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Therefore, just as through one man, talking about Adam, sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because of all sin. So I'm going to blame Adam. No, I sinned too.
Amen.
His sin nature was passed on to me. Well, I'm going to make a stand. I'm not going to sin. Too late. You already did it. You already sinned. Therefore, you deserve the same thing Adam did. Total separation from God. Join the humanity crowd. We all deserve total separation from God. But what does it mean? Because we're talking about this idea of we inherited Adam's sin nature and now we are spiritually dead. Like, what does that mean? This is what I mean. This is stuff I heard as a child in church and nobody ever explained it to me. In church, the pastor would just get up there and read Isaiah 53 and, you know, the organ would turn up and they'll just say a bunch of stuff. And I've been left the building. I'm like, can we get on with the show so I can go play with my friends outside or whatever? No. We're going to explain exactly what's going on here. Amen. So what does it mean to be spiritually dead? All you got to do is look at the Bible. It'll tell you exactly what it means. And this is just one passage I took, and there's several. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 through 3. And you he made alive who were what?
Dead.
And trespasses and sins. In which you walked according to the course of this world. According to the prince of the power of the air. That's the devil. The spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of the what?
Flesh.
Fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others.
Amen.
Got a little formula here. Dead in trespasses and sins. That means that we are a slave to our flesh, what my desires are. No longer, I was created to glorify God. I was created to do what God says to do according to the scriptures. But this sin nature has been, I've inherited that, and now all I want to do is sin. I want to do what my flesh wants to do. And I want to do what the world says to do. You know, if the world says that this is okay now, then I'll go with that. If the world says, you know, homosexuals can do this, and what the world says that, you know, living in fornication is okay, you know, I'm going to rock with whatever the world says. And then I follow the devil. And he has an influence on the other two things. He entices your flesh. He is the prince of the power of the air, which means that he is influencing throughout the world, and you are slave to all three apart from Christ. Whether you believe it or not, whether you like it or not. I try to tell to some people who are into these, some of these other ministries, these deliverance ministries, these prophetic ministries. These are ministries that are put on a fake Jesus mask, but behind them there's just Satan working. Mm-hmm. Taking your money. Mm-hmm. Selling you false hope. Selling you false dreams. Come won't on. Come from the scripture. Just selling you a bunch of foolishness, and they put a false Jesus face on the front of it and said, I want you to buy into this. Mm. Why do they do that? Because they know that you're a slave of your flesh. My flesh say, give me money. Mm-hmm. My flesh say, give me cars, give me houses, give me health, give me wealth. That's what my flesh wants. And the world tells me that I gotta have it. And then Satan entices all of those things, and I'm walking around here a slave to it all. A complete slave. A complete slave. That's what it means to be dead and trespass in sins. We need, does it sound like we need a savior yet? Does it sound like it? Does it sound like we need a savior after hearing all of this? This is some bad news. We're gonna get to some good news, I promise you. Just stick with me. But the good news means nothing unless you understand the situation of your bad news.
That's right. That's right.
But then he says, we were by nature children of wrath. By nature children of wrath. We all deserve wrath because of what? Sin. Mm-hmm. And this is what you'll get when you talk to people out in the world. The question, the wrong question is, how can a loving God pour out his wrath on his creation? Because you know, certain people that we want to focus on the love of God and then to throw away his wrath or his holiness or his justice, when really he's still all of those things. That's the beauty of God. But the right question is, how can a righteous and holy God not pour out his wrath on sin? How could he not? He's holy. If he put up with sin, he wouldn't be holy. If he put up with sin, he wouldn't be just. If he put up with sin, he wouldn't be righteous. My church family have heard me say this before, don't take the analogy too far. But if I had on an all-white suit up here, and I bought that suit, I said, this suit is going to make me look good on Easter Sunday up here. And everybody took and threw coffee at it, threw Mountain Dew at it. You took it, you just threw cake, pie, whatever, and just marred that, tore that suit up. That suit is no good to me because that suit was meant to make me look good. And it no longer makes me good look good. So guess what? 9 times out of 10 for me, you can speak for yourself. That suit, those things weren't coming out. I was going to put that suit in the trash. Why? Because the suit is no longer doing what I designed for it to do. The suit was designed to make me look good. God created us for his glory. That's right. Somehow sin comes in, and now we want to live for our own glory. He is well within his right because he is holy to wipe us out. He is well within his rights to where he did not have to extend any grace to us. He didn't have to. You don't deserve grace. I don't deserve grace. He was well within his right to say, away with them, into hell, later the lake of fire, I'm holy, and they are going to bring this unholiness in my presence. Do they not know who I am? Mm. We lost sight of the reverence and the holiness of God. Yeah. We have completely lost sight of the reverence and the holiness of God. And that's why we do some of the things we do. That's why we go some of the places we go. That's why we even listen to some of the preachers we listen to. Because my flesh telling me that I can have this and I can have that and make the scriptures about me instead of being about God, it is enticing my flesh, and you don't see that the Satan is all in it, influencing it all. We got to get back to sound doctrine. We got to get back to the scriptures. God is holy, therefore he hates sin. He created man to depend on him and glorify him in everything he does. Therefore, all humanity deserves to be totally separated from God due to sin. Romans chapter 6, verse 23a. For the wages of sin is death. That's what he's decided. The wages of sin. That means the due penalty for sin. What you deserve for sin is death. Yes, that's a physical death. You deserve that. But he's saying a spiritual death, which means once you die physically, you deserve to be totally separated away from my grace and my goodness. You deserve to be, and I deserve to be, with Satan and his angels burning forever and ever. That's the wages of sin. But there's good news. I'm glad we made it. I'm glad we made it. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. So what is this? After Adam takes and rebels against God, he listens to his wife, and he chooses his flesh over choosing to do what God says to do, and then God starts to judge him. He starts to pronounce judgment on the woman. He starts to pronounce judgment on Adam. And then he starts to pronounce judgment on the serpent who influenced the matter. Remember, Satan is the one who's enticing and influencing everything. He's the one who's lying about everything. And then he said, he goes and he judged the serpent. And he says, once again, and I'll put enmity between you and the woman and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. This is symbolizing that someone is coming into the world that is going to crush Satan. He is going to bruise the heel of whoever this seed is, meaning by way of persecution, by means of crucifixion. But his life, and we're talking about Jesus here, don't lose sight. The seed, which is Jesus Christ, his life and his death and his resurrection is going to crush the head of the serpent, meaning the devil. That sounds like good news, right?
Amen.
The one that's coming in, that's influencing my flesh, that's influencing the world, he's saying that a seed is going to come, and this seed is going to be Jesus Christ, the God man, the incarnate man. He's going to come in, and he's going to crush the head of the serpent, thereby freeing all who believe. Sound like real good news.
Thank you, Lord.
Just one thing. That ain't happened right then. That's a prophecy.
Yes.
It's got to play itself out. This is what I mean by biblical theology. This means the redemptive plan that is shown throughout the entire Bible. We have to make sure that we're looking at the whole scheme, the bigger picture of the entire Bible. The Bible is about, and this will help you in your reading, the Bible is about God's redemptive story to redeem his creation back to himself through the work and person of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
That's what the Bible is about. It ain't about how you get rich. It ain't about your blessing. It ain't about health, wealth, and prosperity. It's about God's redemptive story of how he's redeeming his creation back to himself through the person and work of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you lose sight of that, you lost sight of it all.
Right. Amen.
If you lose sight of that, you lost sight of everything. So this is not going to happen right then and there. So God, what are you going to do? Because if he's not coming to crush now, then what are we going to do? Got you. Look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. Also for Adam and his wife, the Lord God made tunics of skin and clothed them. In other words, God killed the animal to cover Adam and Eve, emphasizing that death is the penalty for sin. We saw that in Romans chapter 6, verse 23. But introducing the idea of what's known as substitutionary atonement. Big word, I know. But this just simply means that me and you should die, but instead an animal of God's choosing, according to the scriptures, can die in your place to temporarily cover your sins until Jesus Christ, the God-man, invades history to die for the sins of his people. He put a sacrificial system in place, y'all. So that's why we look in the Old Testament and we say, what is all this slaying of a lamb and of a goat and all of this stuff? In other words, what he's saying is you deserve to die. But I'll put a system in place until God come and invades history. God, man, Jesus Christ, God the Son. Until he invades history, I'm going to put a sacrificial system in place to temporarily cover your sins until the appointed time. Look at the grace of God. Look at the grace of God. We go and we're like, I don't understand why. That's the reason why. It's because we deserve death, hell, and the lake of fire. But God has bestowed grace. Look at it. Without going through the entire sacrificial system, but look at two verses of it. Leviticus chapter 16, verse 21 and 22. Just talking about the Day of Atonement. Now, a lot goes on in the Day of Atonement, but I want you to see this and how it points to and relates to Christ. Aaron shall lay both his hands on the head of the live goat, confess over it all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions concerning all their sins, putting them on the head of the goat, and shall send it away into the wilderness by the hand of a suitable man. The goat shall bear on itself all their iniquities to an inhabited land, and he shall release the goat into the wilderness. But they had to do this every year. Every year they have to go and they have to do this. Sin is that serious. But when Christ comes, he comes and he take care of sin once and for all.
Hallelujah.
One time.
Praise the Lord.
One time. This was the system put in place to cover those in the Old Testament until the appointed time. But for us who have repented and believed, it covers us for all time.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Yes.
Amen.
Like the children of Israel, We should have to bear the penalty for our own sin. But God instituted a temporary system to point to the work of Christ. This is the grace and mercy of God. So let's do a quick recap before we move forward. Why did Christ, God the Son, come to die for the sins of his people? To satisfy the wrath of God against sin and reconcile us back to God. God didn't, let me tell you something, man. This is a huge misconception. I went over this, I think, last week in the church. God did not save us from the devil. The devil is the least of our problems when God's wrath is going on.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
When we talk about God's wrath, Satan is the least of your worries. Your biggest worry is that you have sinned against the holy God. And you are subjected to his wrath. Jesus Christ came to satisfy the wrath of God against sin and to reconcile us back to God. Romans chapter 5 verse 9. Much more than having been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. See, that, you see how you make that up? That was just the Bible. However, humanity needs 7 things to be in right standing with God. Remember, sin entered into the world, and now we are not in right standing with God. We got to keep doing these sacrificials, this sacrificial system, where we know kill a lamb, kill a goat, whatever it is that is in the Mosaic law that we got to do to be in right standing with God. What are we going to do to be in right? What needs to be done for us to be in right standing with God forever? Let's look.
We can't do anything.
Yeah, we can't do anything, but what has to be done? We need our sin debt paid. Remember, when we sin, Adam sinned, and the sin nature passed on us, that created a sin debt. That created a sin debt. Back to our passage, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3. For I deliver to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Number 2, we need someone, not just someone, the God man, to live perfectly to fulfill the commands that Adam failed to do. So Adam created us a sin debt. He didn't do what God had told him to do. We need somebody to fulfill this. That's okay, we got scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 21 and 22. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. He fulfills what Adam did. What else do we need? Well, let's see more. We have more on this idea of Adam. Romans chapter 5, verse 18 and 19. Therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation, even so through one man's righteousness, the free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life. For as by one man's obedience, many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience, many will be made righteous. He fulfills what Adam did. The demands that was placed on Adam, the commands that was placed on Adam, who fulfills them? Christ. Number 3, we need to be credited or imputed with that perfect, with a perfect life to be in right standing with God. Okay, so our sin debt is paid. We didn't live a righteous life. How are we going to be received to be righteous in the eyesight of God? Well, Christ lived, and when Christ went to the cross, guess what he did? He lived a perfect life here on this earth. And now, when we repent and believe the gospel, God the Father looks at us through the lens of the Son and declares us righteous. When we put our saving faith in the atoning and the resurrecting work of Jesus Christ, he stands and he covers us and said, you look at me, look at them through the lens of me, I'm perfect. That's what that means. We have been credited with the righteousness of Christ when we believe. Now, I don't know about nobody else, but that's good news. Because when we are in Adam, we got to stand before God ourselves. And I'm full of sin. And I know what sin deserves. Sin deserves to be totally separated away from God. But Christ comes and fulfills what I didn't fulfill. He fulfills what Adam didn't fulfill. And he stands and he covers me. And now the Father looks at me through the lens of the Son. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Glory.
But for any of these first 3 things to be possible in our lives, we need power to be made alive to receive this grace through faith. This is where the resurrection comes in. 4, we need power to make us alive to be aware of our sins and to agree that we deserve death, hell, and the lake of fire because of sin. That's what I've seen over the years. This is some hard thing for people to do, to look at themselves and realize that you're rotten. to look at yourself to realize that I, just me and myself, I deserve to be separated away from God. Instead of looking at the person next to me and be like, nah, they deserve to go to hell, but me, God, I'm good. No, you and him both. We need the power to repent and believe the gospel, that Christ died for sinners. We need power to live holy and blameless lives, dedicating our entire life to glorifying God. We need power to overcome death and the devil. How are we able to receive this power? The resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us power over sin and death because he overcame sin and death. That's point four. The resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us power over sin and death because he overcame sin and death. Jesus' earthly life and death means nothing if he was still dead. We have a Savior that has risen.
Amen.
We have a Savior that is, how can he can't represent you if he's dead.
Amen.
How can you be made alive? Remember, the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives on the inside of you. He was the first fruits. He was raised from the dead. Now guess what? Now we are being made alive in Christ. That's all right. Let's look at scripture. That's okay. Jesus Christ was resurrected, and now by his spirit, he is resurrecting people from the dead, people from being dead in sin to being alive in Christ. How are we saved? Now we got to go into to how are we saved piece of it. What do you mean, Trey, that this resurrection is what causes all of this? Let's go back to how he defines being born again. First, Jesus makes it clear that you must be born again. John chapter 3, verse 3. Jesus answered and said to him, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That sounds like that's something that has to happen. Mm-hmm. If we want to see the kingdom of God, it sounds like we must be, it just makes sense. We must be going born again. How does this happen? Because we are all born spiritually dead because of our sin nature. We inherited from Adam, which means we are naturally born a slave to the world, naturally born a slave to our flesh, naturally born a slave to the devil. So we are naturally born spiritually dead. And that status will not enter the kingdom of God. Therefore, you must be born again. So what does it mean, once again, to be born again? This means that the Spirit of God makes a person alive and new from the inside. The new birth happens when God's Spirit brings to life the human spirit, making a person alive to the things of God. It is total transformation of a person from the inside out. That's what it is. That's what it means to be born again. What did it say when we was in early talking about Lydia? That God opened Lydia's eyes to what the gospel, to the gospel that Paul was preaching. In short, the gospel is preached, and God opens your eyes and gives you a new heart to understand that you are a sinner and deserve the wrath of God. Once again, that's self-awareness, knowing where I stand. That's a big piece. But then you cry out to God to save you from that wrath. Therefore, you repent and believe that Christ saved you from God's wrath for the purpose of being holy and blameless. That's called genuine conversion. When I understand what I deserve, and I cry out to God, oh Lord, what must I do to be saved? And you repent and believe the gospel, that's called genuine conversion. Now you have a new desire to live for God and not for yourself, because that's our problem. We don't want to live for God. We want to live for ourselves. I want to do what I want to do. I want to do what the world say, what TikTok say, what Instagram say, what all those things. I want to do what all that says to do. I don't want to live for God. I want to live for myself. Because in the new birth, God gave you a new heart, enabling you to repent and believe. The problem has always been the condition of man's heart. That's the issue. The condition of man's heart. We want to change all these policies and all these rules. Nothing will be changed until the condition of man's heart has been changed. Which means you need to be born again. What does the Bible say about the heart? Briefly. Genesis chapter 6 verse 5. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and every intent of his thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Jeremiah chapter 17 verse 9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The problem is we need a new heart.
Amen.
And that's what being born again does. It gives you a new heart. It gives you a new heart. The theological term is called regeneration. It gives you a new heart. What does this look like? Ezekiel chapter 36 verse 26 and chapter 36 verse 26 and 27. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will give you a new heart. So if you're still doing the same things you did with that old heart, you need to self-examine yourself. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and will cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and you will do them. That's the evidence of resurrection power. Because God lives and dwells on the inside of you. You are being caused by him to do the will of God in your life because he is your life. Don't be deceived. This is only possible because of Christ's resurrection. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord, Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. If you have truly been born again, you have been made alive spiritually because of God's resurrection power. Because Christ was raised from the dead. That same power that raised Christ from the dead has raised you from the dead, from being dead in trespasses and sins, to be alive in Christ. So Christ has been risen. But have you? Christ is alive and well. And we know this. Why? Because right after 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5, from verse 5 to verse 11, it talks about who saw him. 500 plus brethren saw him. He was seen by many people. How many people know you alive? Spiritually. How many people know that you alive? How many people will come and they'll just see that somebody like, girl, you went to church? I didn't even know you was like that. How many people can say that about you? You can say that about me before I got saved. You went to church? Man, I didn't even think you'd be church tight. All that cussing and foolishness and running around you be doing, all that gossiping you be doing, all that drinking to be drunk you be doing, I wouldn't thought that you were the type to go to church. But I mean, it's Easter. Everybody go to church on Easter. Is your life testifying to resurrection power? Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5 and 6. Even when we were dead in trespasses and sin, even dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We have been made alive in Christ. Look at the scenario. Look at how the scriptures are trying to paint this. I'm almost done, I promise. Look at what the scriptures are painting here. And especially in Romans chapter 6. And this is what I really want you to see. Christ's physical death equals believers dying to sin. Christ's resurrection equals believers being made alive in Christ to live for Christ with the hope of a physical resurrection at his return. So if you have died with Christ, that means that you are dying to your flesh. If you have been made alive in Christ, that means that you live for Christ in hopes of him coming back and receiving your body so you can receive your glorified body and to live in eternity with him. Nothing paints that better than this passage of scripture right here. Romans chapter 6, verse 5 through 11. For if we have been united together in his likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that the old man was crucified with him. Talking about your old fleshly sin nature. The things that you used to do, the places you used to go, the things that you used to do. And that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Remember, we're slaves to sin. Christ's resurrection gave us power over sin. Amen. If you are still a slave to sin, you have rejected resurrection power. For he has died, for he who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we should also live with him. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. That's the thing. What? Christ defeated death. And because Christ defeated death, us as Christians, we have defeated death. Amen. Which means that death has no more power over us. A lot of us, I'm scared to die. Scared to die for what? You're going to live forever with Christ forever. Amen. Life begins when this ends. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourself to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Because Christ is alive, we can also be made alive when we repent and believe. Christ's resurrection makes the following possible. Regeneration, which is being born again. Justification, meaning that we're in right standing with God. Romans chapter 4, verse 25. Who was delivered up because of our offenses and was raised because of our justification. Justification. Because of Christ's resurrection, we also have been adopted. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. Which means that once we are born again and we repent and believe the gospel, we have been transferred out of darkness into the marvelous light of Jesus Christ. And now we are not representing ourselves because Adam inherited our sin, but now we are adopted into the family of God. And it's all because of resurrection power.
Amen. That's
right. Sanctification. Romans chapter 6, verse 11, just read this. Likewise, you also reckon yourself to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. And last but not least, we can look forward to glorification. This is the real good news. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51 through 55. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed, for this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying which that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? Because of resurrection power, and because we have been bestowed grace, and we have received that grace through faith, we don't have to worry about dying, because what death has been defeated by Christ. Now, if he had stayed dead, death would have conquered him. But he rose, which means that he has dominion over death. That's the power of the resurrection. So let's recap as we bring to a close. Number one, we all deserve death, hell, and the lake of fire due to sin. Number two, Christ lived a perfect life for sinners that they couldn't live because of sin. Christ died the death that we should have died because of sin. Christ was raised from the dead to rule over the universe and to make us alive in him, to live for him, anticipating his return. That's a recap of the gospel. If you ever want to know, okay, what's the gospel, just go right there. Go to the scriptures we went to, and if you want to be like, to sum it up, go right there. But I know the average Baptist preacher, they would end on a, you know, hoot and a holler, and, you know, on the third day, and then, you know, we run out of here. I ain't that typical pastor. I got to give you the warning first.
Amen.
I got to warn you. If you come in here and you hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you reject that gospel, the word of God got some words for you. I came and gave you the gospel on this day because I love you. And right now it's saving time, but it ain't going to be saving time long. I got to give you these warnings. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9 through 12. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish because they did not receive what? The love of the truth. This is the truth. Do I love my sin that much that I'm going to reject the truth? Do I value my sin that much that I'm going to reject the truth, knowing that I wasn't created to do that in the first place? I've used this example before. A refrigerator is meant to keep your food cold. That's what the refrigerator was meant to do. What did the refrigerator decide in his mind? You know what? I don't want to make food cold no more. I'm going to just sit here and I'm going to try to change it, make it hot. I'll do something else. That ain't what you was created to do. God created us to glorify him. Are we really going to reject the gospel for us to live a life that's glorifying to God, enabling us to live a life to glorify God, to go and do what we wasn't even created to do? You're not going to find any satisfaction in your sexual immorality, in your drunkenness, And you're gossiping. You're not going to find, it's not going to be any satisfaction. It's temporary.
Amen.
It's temporary. They did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they would believe the lie. Fine, you want the lie? Mm. It's coming to time. Mm. I'm going to turn you over to your evil desires. Right. If you want the lie, I'll give you the lie. That they may be condemned who did not believe the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Matthew chapter 25, verse 31, 34, and 41. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you be blessed, my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. That's good news. But then verse 41, then he will also say to those on his left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devils and his angels. Revelation, last verse, Revelation chapter 21, verse 8. But the cowardly, back at this non-exhaustive list again, the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderous, sexual, immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and liars shall all have their part in the lake of fire, which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. My last point, repent and believe while it's saving time, because when Christ comes back, it's judgment time.
Amen. Good preaching.
It's judgment time.
That's the truth.
That's and a snapshot, not exhaustive at all. The good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yeah, we had a lot of bad news, but I'm going to tell you, the bad news might have been a lot, but that good news overwhelms that bad news. To know that once you repent and believe the gospel, that I'm actually living the life that God has called for me to live, that I'm living a life that is pleasing to him, not because I am within myself can do it, but because he's residing in me, dwelling in me, causing me to do it. And then to look forward to the time when he's going to crack the sky and come back and get me and be eternity with him forever. I mean, that supersedes anything else.
Praise the Lord.
This wasn't a hellfire and brimstone message, but I had to warn you of the hellfire and brimstone.
Yes.
We don't just preach this because we don't want to go to hell. We ought to preach this because we should desire and grow a love for God to desire to be with him.
Yes.
Look at the love and grace that he's bestowed. If you get to know him and you get to know him in these scriptures, you will come to see and taste and see that the Lord is good.
Yes,
everybody. Let me be someone here today who does not know the Lord, and this may have been your first time hearing the full gospel of Jesus Christ, and during that message, just like how Paul preached to Lydia, God opened your eyes to the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you have decided, Lord, what must I do to be saved? I know that I'm rotten. I know that I'm wicked, and I know I deserve your wrath. What must I do to be saved? Simple, repent and believe the gospel. Repent and believe the gospel, truly desire to be with him now and forever. This is the thing when you become a Christian, forever starts now, because you get to the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in you now, to experience God forever, and then you get to experience it apart from sin. So we're saved from the penalty of sin, but we still have the experience of sin here. But then that will be free from all of sin. If that is you, would you come? Why would you come? Because you need some sound biblical people, Christians around you to help you. You can't do this alone.
Yes.
Why should you come? Because you are making a confession of faith that I have been identified with Satan all these many different years, and I want to make a public declaration that I am committing my life to God. If that is you, would you come? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we've had together. We thank you that your word has gone forward, Lord. We thank you of how you've been using your servant. It's not me, Lord. It's not me. This is you working through me. We pray, Lord, that you did make somebody alive in Christ and they repent and believe the gospel. We pray that they would come forward or come see us later so that we can help them along the way. We ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.